still not 100% sold.
Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to the June Planning Commission work session. Let me take the opportunity to welcome Councilwoman Louise Lisa Lucasberg. And Councilman and the Vice Mayor Page Chair. Mr. Bowman.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Good afternoon, everyone. We do have a couple of items for you today for your regular public hearing session. We're going to give you the staff reports on that, and then after that, I've just got a few directors update things on some items we've been talking about before. So we get to that after that. So with that, we'll start with Stacy. I believe she's got our first item, UP 1703. While we're sitting here, I just remind everyone that the July meeting is going to be on the 18th of
right.
July, because of the holiday. So just, it's on the top of my head. I'm sure Regina will remind you probably more than once, but we're reminding ourselves at the same time. We have three applications for that meeting so far.
Okay.
That's saying something for us.
Good afternoon, everyone.
Good afternoon.
Hello. All right, well, I'm going to go ahead and go through my item, UP 1703 in Alpha. And this is an application for a use permit for Safe Harbor Behavioral Health Care for a substance abuse treatment center at 2700 London Boulevard. As you can see from the map here on the left, the property is zoned general mixed-use GMU, and according to the zoning ordinance, a use permit is required for a substance abuse treatment facility, and that is why we're here today. The property is located on the edge of the Port Norfolk neighborhood in the northwest corner of Broad Street and London Boulevard. The property is 1.76 acres in size and contains a one-story 13,475 square foot brick building constructed in 1984. The site contains 89 parking spaces, including 3 handicapped parking spaces. The site's perimeter is heavy landscaped with shrubbery and mature trees along Broad Street and London Boulevard. On the north and west perimeters is privacy fencing. On the south and east perimeters is wrought iron fencing. Now, incidentally, this was the former location of a residential care facility for mentally challenged persons. The use permit was granted back in 2008. The property also housed vans for medical transportation business run by the facility at that time. The operations ceased on the property April of last year. And now I'll provide an overview of the surrounding area. To the north is a warehouse. It's partially occupied by the Virginia Scenic Company, a stage and set company. This property is zoned light industrial IL. To the east is the Economy Lodge Motel and a post office. Both properties are zoned general mixed use, GMU. To the south is the London Oaks Apartments. This is zoned high density urban residential, URH. And lastly, to the west is surrounded by single family residences, so high density urban residential URH. And I'll give you a little bit of an overview of the applicant's request. The proposed substance abuse facility is Safe Harbor's first and only location. The facility will care for up to 25 residential and 40 outpatient clients and be staffed by up to 15 persons. Residential patients will be housed in an area devoted to structured supervised living with care 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. Outpatient care will be offered in the evenings from 6 to 9 p.m. The primary source of the clientele will be referrals from case managers in the Medicaid system, but will also include persons with private insurance and those that have been referred by their physician or other licensed medical professionals. Criteria for the program admission and details of the treatment program were included in your packets. The applicant is going to be here he's been one of the very best applicants. Honestly, he is so prepared to explain the details of the internal workings of the property. I just want to just give you a general overview today. Staff finds the applicant's request for a substance abuse treatment facility complies with the comprehensive plan, which encourages the reinvestment in vacant properties, as well as is compatible with land uses found in the general mixed-use GMU zoning district, which includes professional offices, institutions, and a broad range of light and moderately intensive commercial uses in close proximity to residential land uses. And with the conditions, we are recommending approval of the use permit application. And were there any questions? Absolutely.
With the communications to the neighborhood, is there any response?
There wasn't. I was really surprised. I thought there would be questions or something, but the applicant was so good. He's been in contact with two different civic leagues in the vicinity, and we haven't heard anything. I was really surprised.
I was like, maybe they just can't send it.
I know, right? No, we didn't. We got it, yes. And that was Port Norfolk and Mount Hermon, typically, so that we sent the notice out there. Okay, any questions?
And I'll just do a brief introduction here on the second item that John Harvey is going to present. GP 1705 is a telecommunications tower. I'm not sure how many of you have dealt with these in the past, but I want you to pay attention. John's going to go over some specific requirements we must follow when we're reviewing these kind of applications dating back to the Telecommunications Act of 1996, federal regulations we must comply with as we review these types of requests. So with that, John.
Thanks, Bob. This is the first time we've had any new towers proposed since 2012 when Intellos put up two new towers. Both of them are on Portsmouth Boulevard, one kind of near the shipyard, and another one out by Elmhurst. Communication towers or telecommunication towers are in part governed by the Telecommunications Act of 1996, and there are really six key things that you need to know about the Telecommunications Act. And this information is also in your packet, but it's important enough to go back over before I talk about the actual case. Back in 96, and I was working in another jurisdiction, I remember that Congressman Goodlatte was actively involved at the time in creating this act, and I believe he was in large part responsible for preserving local zoning authority to with certain limitations over the construction of new telecommunication towers. And there are some limitations or exemptions, if you want to call it that, in considering those kinds of facilities. First of all, any decision to deny a telecommunications tower must be in writing. And really that's more important for the council to understand in terms of their processing of the application, more so than Planning Commission. Decisions denying telecommunication towers must be supported by substantial evidence. Localities may not adopt regulations that prohibit or have the effect of prohibiting wireless services. So the community can't just say, we don't want cell phones. Localities cannot adopt regulations that unreasonably discriminate against functionally equivalent providers. So you can't pick two favorites and keep everybody else out. You've got to, part of the intent of the Telecommunications Act was to allow all cell phone providers an equal opportunity to enter any market that they choose to enter. Localities must act on applications within a reasonable period of time. And the last one is it preempts or prohibits localities from regulating telecommunication towers on the basis of environmental effects of radio frequency emissions. So essentially the whole issue of radio frequencies, regardless of what you may think or believe or have read about towers, is not something local governments can get into. If the FCC regulates those areas, that is their territory and theirs alone, not that of local governments. So today you may hear somebody raise concerns about a cell tower having effects on human health or, you know, those kinds of things. The main issue for you today is primarily one of land use and zoning, and that's kind of the realm that you should keep yourself within. You want to add anything to that, or did I cover it with something? So the application you have today is the zoning of the area around the site. It's actually Dale's Auto Repair on Victory Boulevard. It's on the back of the property. And this zoning map gives you a good example of what we call through lots or double frontage lots, where you have a lot that goes all the way from one street to another, so it actually has two frontages. In this case, the main frontage is along Victory Boulevard, but then there's essentially a back door frontage also on Rapidan. Here in Rapidan, you have residential zoning, urban residential, whereas the strip where the tower is proposed in this parcel in particular is on general mixed use. Across Victory Boulevard is the Victory Village property, which is currently zoned mixed use employment. And so that's kind of the zoning situation. The new Royal Farms, just by reference, is on this parcel on Freedom and Victory. This is kind of an oblique aerial view. Probably should have turned it around. It's kind of looking south, I guess, or west. The property's outlined in yellow. Where the tower is proposed is the red star. So again, this area is the general commercial area. Directly across Rapidan is Cavalier Manor, which is zoned urban residential. Of course, to our right, as you're looking at the photo, is the Victory Crossing Shopping Center and commercial area, along with industrial and other uses. This is Dale's Auto Repair. Looking at the front, the lattice tower that you see is actually on the adjoining property, which is where Culligan is, water softening business. When the applicant and I talked about this tower, the concern at that point was that it's an old lattice tower. I assume primarily for CB or radio communication, as opposed to any kind of cellular use. And this is what you would see as you drive along Victory Boulevard. This is Rapidan on the back side, and the building on your left here is the United House of Prayer office building. On your right are the single family residences that are on Rapidan that are part of Cavalier Manor. Picture on the top is the very back of the property, again of Dale's Auto Repair. You can see the wooden fence, and keep that in mind for a minute until I get to the next slide, but essentially the tower will be on this side of that privacy fence. And then the bottom photo are the houses. There are four or five houses in a row there that are essentially directly behind where that tower site is proposed. This is the site plan we received. On the left is the site plan, on the right, far right is a elevation. The tower location is essentially represented by the red triangle. The wooden fence that I mentioned previously is identified by the green boundary line on this plan. So it's behind that fence, essentially facing Rapidan Street. I included the elevation just to give you some idea of the fence, which is this little piece right here, to give you some sense of scale, is a six foot chain link fence. So it gives you some idea of scale. Also, this gives you a representation that not only is the current applicant on the top, but there are also spaces for three additional providers on the tower, which is something that Portsmouth and a lot of other communities encourage to reduce the number of towers you might need in the community. The tower that's proposed is the red star right here. One of the things that we did was that we looked at a number of alternatives sites that would be more appropriate in terms of its surrounding use. We did come to the conclusion that the tower as it's proposed and where it's proposed is inconsistent with the comprehensive plan, in that the plan one of the key objectives is to minimize conflicts between incompatible land uses. Also that prevent impacts or encroachments of incompatible land uses and ensure proper transitions and buffering between different land uses. Introduce transitional uses between lower intensity and higher intensity uses. And again, all of this is in your staff report. But essentially the staff has determined that this is an incompatible land use in relationship to the residences on the other side of Rapidan, that it is an encroachment. It is contrary to the policies of the comprehensive plan, and therefore we're recommending denial of the requested use permit. Rationale for recommending denial is that the location is incompatible with the existing detached single-family residential development, that there is no transition, and in that sense it's transition of uses between the single-family residence and the more intensive cell tower, or buffering between the proposed tower and the residences on Rapidan. Proposed use is inconsistent with the policy and strategies contained in the comprehensive plan, that there are more suitable sites, particularly north of the interstate, that would provide a better location, certainly from a land use standpoint, than what's proposed, and that the existing towers provide coverage of the general area. And I've included that last item. If you look at the propagation maps or the coverage maps that were in your packet, this is not a dead zone for T-Mobile. They have cellular service in that area. What they're trying to do is expand and enhance that service. So they're not filling in an empty gap. They're supplementing the service that they provide now. And with that, I'll try to answer any questions that you may have.
You say that it's not a dead zone. Do you mean not a dead zone to force?
Excuse me?
Do you mean that it's not a dead zone to force, cell force?
There's still coverage in this area. If you were in this area to make a phone call, based on their coverage maps, there's still service in this area. It's just not the highest level of service. So you might get two bars on your personal phone instead of four.
How is the coverage when it comes to data?
I don't know the answer to that question.
If you only get two bars, I'm suspect that it's low.
It's going to be limited to some extent, yes.
So I know T-Mobile, they, well, a long time ago completed their 4G transition or moved to plan their 5G transition. It seems like that's going to be part of this. So I know that would be something they would be looking to do as far as enhanced coverage and stack towers. Have we had feedback back from them on the alternate locations?
No.
Why is it incompatible with the comprehensive plan and there is a communications tower right next door?
The comprehensive plan, well, first of all, the tower that's there now is a historical remnant, I'll call it. It's an old tower. It was never built to handle cellular, at least not compared to the new cellular, the new lattice towers that you see cellular facilities on. The general policies of the plan are to discourage those incompatible land uses. The plan was written in 2005. The tower predates that. I think you'll find all around Portsmouth where those land use conflicts exist, and the intent of the plan was to reduce those conflicts over time.
So are there any service provider telecom towers in the Victory Crossing area?
Not to my knowledge. I have not. I'm not aware of any, and I've looked. If you look at your coverage map, mm-hmm. there basically is T-Mobile has sites northeast and southwest of this site.
Right.
And I didn't include those maps on here, but I've got them.
Now, how about that?
Yeah. You're pretty familiar with coverage maps.
Yeah, they don't always mean coverage.
No, I understand. John, if I understand you correctly, you're saying that if Culligan came in and said, we want to put up a tower, it would be denied now. If they did not have that lattice tower up, we would not allow them to put one up, correct?
Based on the policies and objectives of the comprehensive plan, staff would recommend that it be not denied based on the policies of the comprehensive plan.
Okay.
Okay. So the main thing is, I wonder if Culligan's even using that tower. It is a CBT. That was prior to being Culligan, that was a Cox Communications building.
Oh, okay.
So I was there when it was a Cox building. And so it's not something that no one uses.
Let me just mention one other thing, just from a general land use perspective. You know, the way the lots are laid out there, this tower is directly in front. These houses are facing Rabbit Ann Street, so you're basically putting this tower. I think the distance separation is 60 feet.
Right across the
street. It is really close to those existing residents over there. And that right there, is from a zoning perspective and from our comprehensive plan perspective, that is almost the definition of being incompatible. To have a tower of that size, that close to your front door. That is, in essence, you know, John kind of went through the whole list of all our policies that are intended to deal with that. This is exactly the kind of circumstance we would try to avoid. Now, this obviously is a decision up to the Planning Commission and City Council ultimately to decide. But from a land use perspective, that's the kind of situation we would normally want to try to avoid, is having this type of a 165-foot tall, very large tower that close to someone's front yard.
What does the Civic League say?
We, at this point, we have not heard anything from the Civic League directly. We did send them notices. They're going to be here today.
Oh, cool.
I know when the Royal Farms went in, one of the issues was, should they have access to the back to Rapid Inn? And we basically said, no, you couldn't, because that's really a residential street. And if there was access here, then you'd have people coming down Cavalier Manor. Is that Cavalier Manor
that's
Boulevard? And coming in the backside.
Right.
And you know, one of the things as planners you try to do is commercial industrial traffic off of residential streets. It's an incompatibility from a land standpoint.
Do we expect to have T-Mobile here today?
I believe there's somebody here representing T-Mobile. I'm sure they'll make a presentation or make comments.
And this is a private property.
This is a private. This is private property. Let's get back to the site plan. The lease, basically, what I gather from the information submitted is that they're leasing this entire site for cellular service. T-Mobile is interested in just essentially this area in the tower. So there's expansion room should the other three providers come down.
I guess my question would be where it is, how that's probably central to where they want to get service. Would it be just as central across 264 by the jail and that Ellsworth area?
And my response to that is whether that's as prime a location as this might be from a land use standpoint, it's a more appropriate area on the other side of the interstate because it's almost entirely.
I understand the land use position, but I'm also trying to get to where can they best enhance the service?
Yeah, I think that's a question you need to ask.
Yeah, that.
We're not cell communication experts. We're not intending to be. Those are kind of questions you want to ask the service provider, what their needs are. And they're very valid questions. We're pointing out, the more appropriate locations from a land use perspective.
Yeah, because that Victory Crossing area is really growing.
Yes.
And we recognize there's changes in the telecommunications industry. We're going to be seeing more or different types of requests for technology advances, and we're going to have to try to keep up with it from a land use perspective, that balance between land use and demand for service, because we also recognize that if you're providing a service where there's a consumer demand, we recognize that as well. And that's one of the reasons that the 96 Telecommunication Act was tried to support consumer demand and get it expanded. So this is the Land Use Balancing Act you get into, which is
There's one other thing that I should point out. Staff has recommended denial, and the reasoning behind that was listed on the screen. It's in your staff in the staff report. One of the things that we try to do where we recommend denial is also anticipate that you may want to, or council may want to, approve. And so we've included suggested conditions in the event that you wish to make a recommendation to approve. Our perspective on that is that we provide that to you if you feel differently than the staff as a recommendation, then at a minimum, those are conditions that would mitigate those impacts we're most concerned about to the greatest extent possible. So that is there for you to consider should you wish to recommend it. Questions, comments?
Thank you.
Thank you.
I'll move into our new business items. Still give you a few updates. I think you're pretty well aware from the joint meeting with the City Council and from our earlier discussions, we've got a fair amount of zoning ordinance work underway, or about to be underway. So let me give you a couple of updates on the parking regulation update we've been working on. We are in the process of reviewing final draft. We expect to have that completed in July. And hope to have that, and I'm just going to say hope, which I say hope is not a plan, but hope to have that in the public hearing process, the Planning Commission, in September. So that's the timer for the parking. On the signs, we are, I won't say we're in the final draft yet, but we're closing in on the final draft of our signs. That is expected to be a topic of conversation at your joint meeting with city council in July. They have another one coming up. I believe it's the 24th of July. That topic will be on there, assuming that goes well or we don't get a whole lot of changes in there. We also would like to get the signs scheduled for public hearing for in front of the Planning Commission. Again, we're targeting September. It all depends a lot on what Planning Commission and City Council have to say on both of those items as we go along.
What signs are we talking? Street signs?
No, we're talking the cities, not in the street. That's covered under Chapter 32 of the City Code, which is streets and sidewalks. That's right. Under engineering. This is all the commercial, institutional signs you might see.
Okay.
Temporary signs, whole banners, a whole slew of it. Pretty much everything that's on private property, any signage on private or public property, excluding right-of-way and sidewalks. So that's the target. Also let you know, in our as far as the zoning ordinance itself, we've been in the process of going through consultant selection. We're in the final stages with hopefully in our contract, and we expect to have a consultant that we can announce under contract this month. And that project's going to start instantaneously, because council, you know, has obviously given us the impetus to get it done quickly. So we hope to have the consultant underway in June, by the end of June at least. We'll keep you posted, obviously, at your meeting in July as to where we are with all of that. So we're pretty excited to kind of get all that underway. And then the last thing, I'm just going to ask Brian very quickly, we have a public meeting coming up next week. I want to just mention our D2 land use plan. You know, that's another thing we're working on, is the precursor to creating the new zoning for the D2 district, replacing the form-based code. With that, I'll just have Brian add a couple of words here.
So next Tuesday at 2 o'clock, 2 to 4, in the social services building, the fourth floor, 1701 High Street, we're going to be rolling out the final draft of the land use plan, or final draft to the public before we get it sent to you all and to City Council for your review as well. The draft will be available either this afternoon or tomorrow on the Build Law Enforcement website. The plan will be there, as well as the supporting appendices, which are the more technical documents. It's the information that kind of led us to the conclusion that you'll find in the land use plan. So we're excited about this. I think the plan looks beautiful. I think that the people, when they see it, will be happy with it. I think that we've done a good job of incorporating the feedback that we got from the public, figuring out what land uses should go where, neighborhood, and then, like Bob said, when we get into the zoning ordinance rewrite, we use that as the basis for the zoning out in that district to try to better align the allowable uses and the ease of getting uses permitted out there with what people are trying to have in their neighborhood.
What date is that?
Tuesday the
13th.
Sorry.
You said we have a joint meeting with City Council on the
24th of July, I believe.
It's
on the schedule they adopted back when City Council first set up their regular meeting with their various boards and commissions. So that'll be the 24th. We are working on having a pretty full, although part of this is meet and greet and getting to know council members better. You know, from our perspective, we'd like to take advantage of your joint presence, and since you do have items you work on collaboratively with City Council, conference of plan, zoning, things of that nature, we do plan to have a pretty robust agenda for the two bodies to work through and give us guidance on, so we can continue to work on the plans. I think you're pretty well aware the comp plan is just past, I think about halfway, a little past halfway mark on the comp plan, obviously. That is a topic we haven't had I'll call it a sort of a robust presentation conversation on with the two bodies yet. So that's one of the topics we'll have on that meeting. So hope you can all make it. I know mid-July is probably not everybody's favorite time to have extra meetings, but I hope you can try to make it to that meeting, because it's going to be a full night.
Do we have a time for that?
6 o'clock. 6 until you get done. like going out on the weekend.
Is windows locked?
I don't think it'll be 6 to 6:15.
Y'all will enjoy it. People will enjoy it, especially.
And that's all we have.
I'll be in town.
Chairman, that's all we have.
Thank you. Anyone else for the commissions? Anyone else for the good of the talk? Okay, again, as always, thank you. It's now 1:15. Let's be seated by 1:30. So we can start on time.
Thank you, sir.
In church.